Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. The COVID outbreak here in Sydney is getting in the way of us recording a fresh lineup of shows for you. So for the next several weeks, we've got some past episodes lined up for you to enjoy. This one, DNA Surprises, was hosted by my colleague Janice Peterson. It is such an intriguing episode. I hope you enjoy it just as much as I did.
I got this email saying there's a DNA link, so when I click on it and there pops up that this is 99.99% your father. So I'm like, holy crap.
What were you hoping to find out?
I virtually wanted to find out my ethnicity.
We shared the right amount of DNA, and I thought to myself, wait a minute. Could this man be my father instead of my dad?
Absolute shock and awe to, hey, I've got a daughter I didn't know about.
I've sent off that DNA of mine, that sample. Do I own that DNA now?
We don't really know the answer, and that sounds outrageous, but that's the state of law at the moment.
Any regrets about taking this DNA test?
Absolutely. I felt as if someone punched me in my stomach and I couldn't breathe.
Well, welcome everyone to Insight. Debbie, you're 54. Your partner actually bought you a DNA testing kit for your birthday. Why was that?
I wanted to know my ethnicity. I knew I had Polynesian blood in me from my mother's side, but I also wanted to know the ethnicity on my father's side.
And so when you get this kit, tell us what's involved. What do you have to do?
You basically spit in a tube. And then you send it back to whichever company you've used and they analyse it and then they upload your results.
Now, Kim, you're 60. Mm-hmm. Coincidentally, about 6 weeks before Debbie sent off her kit, you had one done as well.
Yes, I did.
What were you hoping to find out?
I virtually wanted to find out my ethnicity, and I was born in New Zealand and I had a grandmother who was part Maori. So I really wanted to know how much Polynesian I had.
Tell us about what you found out about that Polynesian heritage.
I didn't have any. I didn't have any at all. And I was a bit... I was actually very confused. I thought, this doesn't make sense. And so much so that I rang the company and they said to me, well, you simply may not have the markers that we test, and that's why it's not showing. It niggled in the back of my mind, but I thought, OK, I get that.
And Linda, you're joining us from LA. Now, your husband bought you a DNA testing kit. What were you hoping to find out?
Well, I was hoping to see my ethnicity. I wanted to see my mom's Scotch-Irish English heritage and my dad's German heritage reflected in the DNA test.
And we can see a photo of you here in the studio with your parents, the people you grew up with. Tell us about what they told you. Apparently they said that you were a miracle baby. Why did they say that?
My parents told me I was born 16 years into my parents' marriage. They told me that my dad had issues, and so he went for fertility treatments, basically, and that I was planned and was a miracle baby, basically.
Rose, you're joining us from New Orleans. Lovely to see you. You're 70 years old. Now, you had a DNA test done around about a year ago. What prompted that?
My granddaughter. She was anxious to find out how much Italian we had in us. And when it came back, the surprise was there was no Italian.
How on earth did you feel?
I felt as if someone punched me in my stomach and I couldn't breathe.
How much of your identity was tied up with that cultural heritage of yours being Italian?
A lot. Decorations all over my house are Italian. My mother went to Italy and brought back all kind of things for us from Italy. I have a wallpaper border around my kitchen of Italy. that's coming down soon.
And did anyone else in the family have a test done?
Yes, I convinced my oldest brother to take the test because my grandmother and grandfather and my daddy were all born in Italy. So when he got the test and it came back, he was my half-sibling.
Was that a huge shock for you?
Yes.
And
very much so.
How did your brother react?
He said, nothing's changed, but everything's changed.
And so what did your brother's test actually show?
That he's 58% Italian.
So did you manage to find out who your biological father was?
Yes, through the DNA that I was matched with a cousin that my brother wasn't matched with. And he recognized the last name as being a next-door neighbor to my grandparents.
That must have been a huge revelation.
Yes.
Tell us how you felt.
I still don't know how I feel.
Have you had any contact with half-siblings?
Yes. I wrote him a letter. His name's Billy. And about 3 weeks ago, I sent the certified letter to him. He signed it, and 2 days later, he called me. And he's taking the DNA test now to confirm that his daddy is my dad, and we're going to take it from there. He wants confirmation, but he's pretty sure. He said his daddy was a player.
Looking back on your life, the family life, was there ever a moment where you thought, I don't really fit in here. Something's not right.
Yes, constantly. I'm 5'2" and my brother's a 6'2". My dad was 6'3" and my mom was 5'9". I was the shortest one in the family. They all had black hair, dark brown eyes, and I had blonde hair and green eyes.
And so you weren't so much the black sheep of the family, you were the fair sheep.
No, I was the fair sheep.
Now, Linda, we'll go back to you. You grew up with German ancestry, didn't you? What came back after your DNA test?
Well, when the DNA came back, it showed Western Europe. So I thought, well, that accounts for my dad's German heritage. And it showed Irish and Scottish and English. And I thought, well, that's my mom's heritage. But there was another ethnicity that came back that completely confused me. And the DNA test said that I was one quarter Iberian, which is Spain and Portugal. And I thought, well, I wonder where that comes from. And then I also showed 10% Native American, and I had no idea where that came from. So I thought it was kind of strange, but I thought, oh, okay, oh well. So I just kind of put it away and didn't think about it again for 7 months until I got an email from a woman who said she was my cousin. And I didn't have any idea that the DNA companies match you to other people who have tested with the company that you share DNA with.
So what happened when you dug a little bit deeper into some of the details that were contained in those DNA results?
I looked through my DNA matches and I saw people that I could recognize were related from my mom's side, had my mom's maiden name and my grandmother's maiden name. And then I started looking for people who matched on my dad's side. And I looked and looked and looked, and I couldn't find anybody with my dad's surname, which was when I started to get suspicious that something was not right.
And what did you make of it?
What was most strange to me was that I discovered, and I noticed as I was looking through my matches, that about three quarters of my matches had Hispanic last names. And I didn't have anybody in my family who was Hispanic.
And then you started thinking more, didn't you, about your childhood. Tell us about that.
I noticed one particular name that seemed to jog a memory that I had. And the last name was Chavez. And all of a sudden, I remembered a man that my mother was friends with when I was growing up, when I was a little girl. And she had actually taken me to visit him when I was very little. And I had known him just to be my mom's friend. But all of a sudden, I thought to myself, wait a minute. Could this man be my father instead of my dad?
What happened next?
It was 2 a.m. in the morning when it all of a sudden hit me that this man may be my biological father instead of the man who raised me, my dad. And I had memories that I had completely forgotten that I had visited him. I heard my mother's voice speaking to me saying, I took you to see Bill Chavis, that was his name. The next morning, I decided to build Bill's family tree because I love genealogy. So I went on to one of the family tree type websites where my DNA was, and I built up his tree. Using public records, I was able to figure out who his parents were and who their parents were. And then what I did was I used one of the features that the DNA company allows you to do, which is to attach your DNA results to a family tree. And so what I did was I attached my DNA to Bill's family tree. Well, within hours, I had probably 200 DNA matches that matched me on Bill's family line. And that was a huge clue that I was onto something and that my dad was not my dad.
So we saw a photo of Bill Chavis here in the studio. When did you first see that picture?
Well, I did some research after I figured out that Bill was probably my biological father. And I was able to locate some first cousins that were local to me. They actually had lived around me my whole life. I grew up near them and didn't even realize it. So I was able to contact one of them, and she agreed to take a DNA test. And so she took a DNA test, and we waited about 6 weeks, but at the end of that test, she showed up in my DNA matches at the correct level for first cousin. We shared the right amount of DNA to be first cousins, and that confirmed for me that Bill was indeed my biological father. And I noticed that my three adult sons looked just like him.
Quite incredible. Well, we've got, Linda, pictures here of you, your biological father and his mother. I reckon there's a pretty strong family resemblance there. What was your reaction when you saw all of those photos?
Everything started to make sense. I looked enough like my mother that I never really questioned the fact that I didn't look like my dad. But once I saw the photo of my biological father and then my biological grandmother and even my biological father's sisters, then all of a sudden everything made sense.
Rose, your mother died 9 years ago. How do you feel about her? And with all of these revelations that you've had to grapple with,
I was upset at first, but the more I thought about it, my birth certificate father, I'd have cheated on him too. I'm sorry.
Why do you think your mother took this information to the grave? Why didn't she tell you?
I don't know, but she knew. She knew I was not my birth certificate father's child.
Did you feel betrayed by your mum that she didn't reveal this to you?
Yes, because she and I were close. She had plenty of opportunity to tell me, but why she chose not to, I have no idea.
Was there anything she said that you think she was perhaps trying to let you know?
Well, my oldest brother had brown hair and brown eyes. My second oldest brother had black hair and dark, dark eyes. And I had kind of blondish red hair with green eyes. And I asked her, what was with all the different combination of colors, and she said, oh, the milkman, the postman, and your daddy. So I didn't... Wasn't too far from the truth.
Okay, so she may have been dropping hints. Kim, your results came back. You found out there was no Polynesian heritage. A bit of England, Ireland, Scotland, bit of North Europe and Norway thrown in too. Now, you posted these results on Facebook. Yeah. What happened next?
That was Christmas Day. I got a phone call from an old friend. I hadn't seen him for 30 years. And he said to me, Kim, I think you need to know the truth. And he goes, you're adopted. So I had my kids there, I had my kids' friends there, so I was trying to hold it together, which I did manage for a little while, and then I lost it. I ended up phoning people, you know, phoning my mother's mum's best friend and saying, is this true? Just phone calls everywhere, text messages, and everybody knew but me. Everybody knew. I don't know how they kept it a secret for nearly 60 years.
Yeah. How did that make you feel, that you were in the dark?
Well, when I was a kid, I actually had asked Mum a couple of times, am I adopted? And she just lied to me, you know?
Do you understand why she might have kept it hidden?
I don't know, maybe she was just too scared. You know, maybe she was just simply too scared.
Debbie, you got your DNA test results back in February. What did they show?
I had a very close match that I had no idea who she was. And only about 10 minutes after I got my results, she messaged me. And she's like, I'm so pleased, you know, you've got your results and that you're my closest living relative as such. And I'm like, I sort of got off the computer and went to my partner and said, what the? Who is this woman? Where does she fit in?
So tell us, who is this woman?
My half-sister. And it wasn't really confirmed to me until I had it confirmed by my mother. It was actually the same day it happened. And I was visiting my mother in New Zealand. And she sort of confessed to me when I mentioned the same name of the man who my half-sister's father was. Her mother mentioned the same name. And my mother sort of went into shock.
Can you tell us who your half-sister is?
Kim.
There we go. So what was that revelation like?
It was pretty big because I'd gone home to visit my mother in New Zealand and it was, like I said, the same day.
And what did she say?
Well, I'm just sort of like to Mum, like, what do you mean? And then she confessed she had a brief affair or even just like a fling, like for a few hours type thing.
Sometimes that's all it takes.
Yeah. And I ended up getting a lot of information out of my auntie, her sister, because my auntie had also dated this man, right, who's our bio father, and she ended up sending a photo to me of him. It's the only photo we've ever seen of him.
And then when you saw the photograph of this man who turned out to be your biological father, how did you react? What did you see in that photograph?
I saw myself, to be honest, because I do look like him, you know, a fair bit. We've searched for months and months to try and track him down, but we're at the stage where we've got over 700 DNA matches to the paternal side.
No.
Shared matches. Mm. So we can virtually see who our great-grandparents are, but then it gets a bit murky, and we've been told from that family that a lot of the men in that family had extra children.
Kim, it's a bit different for you, isn't it? Because you went from being an only child in an adoptive parent situation, and now you've also found your biological mum and other siblings, haven't you?
Yes, I have. I did that pretty quickly. I wrote my birth mother a letter and I waited for 10 days. Didn't get an answer. I couldn't couldn't take it any longer, so I phoned her. Mm. Yeah. So that was the beginning of that.
And how has that gone for you?
Look, I think she was really pleasant, surprisingly, like really nice, but I know that she was finding it very difficult to talk to me on the phone. She was 15 when she got pregnant, 16 when she had me, and I think she was shamed, and I think she felt that she hurt her parents terribly, and she had all sorts of guilt feelings. She was also told to never ever speak of it again, not even to her parents. And we're still in communication today. I've met my other siblings. I've been to New Zealand a couple of times and spent time with her, and we email. So, yeah.
Linda, you've joined a Facebook group to reach out to other people who have had similar experiences. Why is that?
It makes such a huge difference to know that you're not alone. When you make this discovery, it just completely changes your world. And to be able to relate to other people who have made the same discovery is huge. People don't understand what it's like unless they've been through it.
Rose, tell me, did you expect your life would be turned upside down by taking a simple online DNA test?
No, and I tell everyone now that mentions taking it, be sure you're ready for anything. My husband helped me get through a lot of it. When I first found out, he came up to me and he said, he put his arm around me and he said, I want my money back. And I said, you want your money back? He said, yeah, I thought I married an Italian. You're not Italian.
You were hoping to find some health information. What have you been able to discover there?
More than I bargained for. Like 30 times more likely to go blind. Schizophrenia genes or cancer of the bowel, liver, prostate, which is all good to know, but it's a lot to take in one go.
What did you find out?
Two BRCA genes. So both pathogenic, which scared me.
Nicole, who did you think your biological father was growing up?
The guy who raised me, Max. Yeah, didn't know any different.
So how did you find out he wasn't your father?
My mother died and I took some time off work and I received a phone call. She goes, I'm your mum's best friend and I've been trying to track her. And that's when I found out. So, yeah, I got a phone call from someone I never met.
That must have been a huge shock.
A little bit of a shock.
Please. Did you think she was fair dinkum?
I ended up ringing up one of my mum's friends and going, do you know this lady? She went, oh, yeah, she did nursing training with her in Sydney.
A month mourning your mother passing, you're grappling with all of that, and then a woman calls to tell you that the man you thought was your father is not your father. So yes. What did she actually tell you in that phone call?
Did your mother ever tell you about your real father? No, she didn't. Thank you very much for letting me know that on the telephone. Spectacular. So, yeah. Yeah, that was it.
And how did you go about then finding out who your biological father was while you're grappling with all of this horrible events that have been happening?
I went trawling through her address book and I ended up finding a lady who apparently looked after me when I was a kid. Do you know anything? She goes, all I know is he was military police and his nickname was Stretch. That's all anybody knew.
Patrick, you're 68. Your wife, Susie, kindly bought you a DNA test a couple of years back. What were you looking for?
Two things: to get her off my back, because she'd already done hers, and to really find out where I was. I knew my mother's family was Irish, my dad was Scottish, and I just wanted to see where. I knew it was going to be a very boring, mundane report.
And then you get a notification from the website.
Well, I got the report that said I was Irish, Scottish, Scandinavian and Melanesian. So that was a little bit of a stand up and have a look at yourself bit. And then about 2 weeks, it seems, I don't know how long, it's just I got this contact from the ancestry place that we were looking at, and it said we have a direct relation. And I showed my wife, and she just burst into hysterical laughter. She said, "Your pastor's caught up with you." And I said, "No way, no." And I'd know if there was anything. The DNA was wrong.
Nicole, yes. Tell us who your biological father is.
Patrick. Yeah. Yay.
So this is... So this tall man sitting next to you is Stretch.
Yes, apparently so. A little bit older than what they described and a bit greyer, but yeah. It's a lot greyer. So,
how did you discover that?
I decided to sign up for an ancestry.com. I got this email saying there's a DNA link, so when I click on it and there pops up that this is 99.99% your father. So I'm like, holy crap. So, yeah, that's how I found out. And then I popped on the email to have a look at the little email from him. Spelt my name wrong, but that's OK. Always. Hi, my name's Patrick. Apparently we're a match. Would you like to meet, catch up and talk a bit more?
Take us back to that first phone call you had with Patrick.
Yeah.
You're 45 years old, and for the first time you're about to speak to your father. What was it like?
I think we were on the phone for about 3 hours in the end, weren't we?
Yeah. It was a good talk. Yeah.
Well, you had plenty of catching up to do.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's my one regret. This little girl grew up without me knowing her. I really regret that. Really, it's something I wish I'd known. I truly wish I'd known.
So how do you feel then about Nicole's mother? Were you able to figure out why she didn't let you know?
We've asked this question of each other 100 times. I'd just come back from Vietnam. I wasn't in a good place and I wasn't a very nice person. And that could be part of the reason. That's all I can think of.
Georgie, you're 25.
Yes.
Now, a friend of yours decided to give you a DNA testing kit as a gift. Why was that?
I've known her my whole life, and she has known about me that I have two mums and I was born through IVF back in 93. So we've always talked about how it would be interesting to know what my heritage was. So she got me the test for my birthday.
This has all happened relatively recently too. I think you only got the test results back about a month ago.
Yep.
What did it show?
So I have three siblings, half-siblings, that I'd never even considered to be in existence, I guess.
How did that make you feel?
Shocked, surprised.
And then around about an hour, very quickly after you got those results about a month ago, you get a message.
Yeah.
What did it say?
Something along the lines of, "Hi, do you see Zach White and Nathaniel Sherwood as your close family matches?" And I thought, oh my God, yes, those two boys are there.
Okay.
They're actually my half-siblings and your half-siblings too. Welcome to our half-family. I know who our donor is. If you want a picture, I can send it to you. Otherwise, call me, email me, Facebook me, whatever you want. Just let me know and I'll be there, essentially. So, yeah, I got home and they had all added me on Facebook and we chatted.
And what's it been like being not really reunited but getting to know these half-siblings of yours?
Yeah, weird. I don't know, it's only been 4 weeks. It feels like it's been half of my life.
And are you able to tell us who they are?
Yeah, they're just the two boys and the girl sitting next to me.
Check it out. Wow. And so the four of you, suddenly you have an instant half-family.
Yeah, exactly. It's very strange.
So we've got Jacqueline, Nat and Zach.
Zach and Nat.
Sure.
Whichever order works, mate.
Yeah, you're all obviously matched online.
Yeah.
And so who's met face-to-face?
Well, I found out on the Wednesday and was talking to them all that night, and Zach lives in Melbourne but Nat lives in Sydney, and Nat was already coming down that Sunday just randomly for something else.
Okay.
And they already had plans to hang out, so I met them that weekend, but met Jacqueline about 2 hours ago.
2 hours ago. This is as fresh as it gets.
Yeah.
How was that meeting?
Yeah, it's been good. Weird. Feels I feel like a bit like we're a science experiment or something. So I see myself in all of them, especially Zach. So it's, yeah, it's bizarre.
So, Jacqueline, your sperm donor father, when he did donate, wanted to be anonymous.
Yeah.
You put on your super sleuth hat. You managed to track him down. Can you tell us about his reaction when you reached out to him?
Well, it was a bit... It was hard. I think he took it rather well, but it was a difficult conversation. I think we were both holding back a little bit and not really sure what we were talking about. But I think I said I won't get in touch with you if you don't want to.
And have you heard back from him?
Yes. So he emailed me. He emailed me a pretty brief email saying, I'm happy to answer any more questions. I emailed back and said, would really like a photo of you at our age, just to compare what we look like. I think I had another couple of questions. He answered those. And I emailed back, but I haven't heard from him since.
Sure. Nat and Zach, how have you gone processing all of this information?
I was lucky enough to have two mums as well, so it's pretty clear. They were always very open about where I was conceived, and so it wasn't really a massive shock, except when you actually look in their eyes.
Yeah.
That's the strangest part.
Tell us about that, what it's like.
Oh, we still can't really do it. It makes our stomachs turn a bit.
I don't know, it's just weird to look someone in the eye that looks so similar to you that you never really knew existed.
Happened before.
Like, when we look each other in the eye, we kind of, like, hold the gaze for a little bit too long, so it's like, oh, shocking.
Right.
Yeah.
And you live nearby, don't you?
Yeah, we live about 10 minutes from each other.
Gosh.
And the day we met, later on, we figured out, actually, that we go to the same pub all the time. So that was pretty weird to know that, like, we've definitely run into each other before.
Nat and I grew up like 15 minutes away from each other. Gosh. We had the same friends.
Really?
We're both musicians. We both do.
I think the craziest thing about that, it was 10 minutes from each other, 600-700 kilometres away from the clinic.
Yeah.
There are a lot of misconnections there with Zach and I growing up. As he said, we're both musicians, and a lot of the guys that I used to play in bands with knew Zach. So when the day rocked around where I got my results back and I found Jack and Zach, I immediately went to Facebook, as you do. And when I looked up Zach and I found that he had, like, a bunch of mutual friends with me, that kind of blew my world, that he was from the neighbouring school in the country. Yeah.
And Zach, you were hoping to find some health information, weren't you, through your sperm donor father. You've also used third-party websites to find out more information. What have you been able to discover there?
More than I bargained for. like 30 times more likely to go blind by the time I get older. Either got schizophrenia genes or cancer of the bowel, liver, prostate, which is all good to know. But it's a lot to take in one go.
Of course it is. Corinne, you have used one of these third-party websites as well after you had your DNA test done.
Yeah.
What did you find out?
When I uploaded it, the very first thing that popped up at the top, even before my sex, which is, you know, supposed to be the most important thing, was two BRCA genes. So both pathogenic, which scared me quite considerably. I have a strong family history of cancer, both on my mum's and my dad's side. And I kind of always suspected that I was going to follow my dad's line. And having that BRCA gene, well, two separate BRCA things pop up, it scared me to death. It really did.
It sounds like you've got a lot more to worry about now.
Yeah, but I'm glad I found out. I found another direct-to-consumer site for genetic testing, genetic health testing, and I sent my DNA off there.
So you sent your DNA off to that site. What did that tell you?
I came back with not BRCA, which I thought was awesome to start with. I came back with a CHEK2 mutation.
What does that mean?
It's a different cancer gene, but instead of just affecting breasts, it affects colon, bowel, breast, brain, skin, thyroid. There's a lot more to be concerned about.
And have you taken any action with this new knowledge?
Absolutely. My first step was to go back to my doctor with the results and ask for another genetic counsellor. I had a colonoscopy this year, which is, I'm 47. They generally say you don't need to start checking your colon or anything like that until you're 50. I would have developed cancer within 2 years, according to my colonoscopy surgeon.
Is that right?
So I had polyps that were on the verge of turning. So by the time I turned 50, I would have already been fighting colon cancer.
So you must be glad that you've done that test then.
I have never been so relieved about anything in my life. Watching my grandfather die of colon cancer, I was just a little girl. I was 10 when he died. And I was really close to him. It was devastating.
Vanessa, you map the human genome. We know that DNA tests can reveal all sorts of things about health issues. Just how reliable is that sort of health information from these online websites?
Well, it was interesting to hear the previous story that, the original test came back with BRCA mutations, which would be an alarm bell for breast cancer, correctly so. So I suppose what your story portrays is exactly where the field is at the moment, in the fact that there are some errors because it was confirmed you didn't have a BRCA or BRCA mutation, but you had a CHEK2.
So there are limitations as far as the health outcomes go. What about in terms of family history and the accuracy of people's heritage?
So the accuracy of people's heritage from the stories, as we've heard tonight, is very accurate because we're talking about siblings, we're talking about parents, cousins, second cousins. That is accurate. What is probably a bit limiting still at the moment is if you have a lot of indigenous cultural history, if your genetics goes back to Africa, it's still a bit limited. But the kind of research we're doing, for example, in our lab, is you'll be amazed that we can actually tell your ancestry all the way back to day one.
Vanessa, how is your test different to the commercial ones then?
So how it's different is that we are researchers, so we feed that information into the databases that the commercial companies then use. And that's why, I don't know if you've noticed, for all of you who've had your DNA tests, you will see that your information keeps on changing. You think, gee, have I become more Scandinavian? Why have I become less this and more that? And that's only because the companies are improving the information as our scientists put more information in the database. So as the databases get better and better, your ancestry information becomes more specific.
Well, Brad, you work for one of the companies that collects this sort of DNA data. How accurate do you think the testing is?
Well, the testing's very accurate. Certainly the testing that connects people together is very accurate, and the closer the match, the higher the level of accuracy.
Jane, you're a lawyer, you're also a genetic counsellor. You've done a lot of work looking into these sorts of companies that carry out these tests. What are they doing with that data after they've collected it from us?
That's a really good question, and that, you know, depends to a large extent on the company that you're looking at. Obviously, the biggest ones are 23andMe and Ancestry.com. They're amassing really large databases, and a lot of people are sending their data to those companies. But there are hundreds of small companies who are offering all sorts of testing. And what each company does with that data varies. It depends on some of the relationships that they have, and it varies according to the terms and conditions that people sign up to when they send off their spit to the company. And so 23andMe, we know, have relationships with pharmaceutical companies. It was in the news recently that they signed a big deal with GlaxoSmithKline. Some people felt really uncomfortable about that. I think people don't always realise when they check a box to say, yes, we'd like this to go to research, that it's actually going to a pharmaceutical company for profit rather than maybe to a hospital for cancer research. We know that there are other relationships with researchers and other third parties that companies can send data to or can share data with, and people don't always know exactly what will happen with their data.
So what happens then? I've taken my swab, I've spat into the tube, whatever it is, I've sent off that DNA of mine, that sample. Do I own that DNA now? That is a very good question. And unfortunately, it's one we don't really know the answer to. And that sounds outrageous, but that's the state of law at the moment. Certainly in Australia, there is very unclear laws around the ownership of DNA. And there's another layer to it when you're sending it off to another country. What does that mean if it passes Australia's borders and it goes to another country? That adds complexity to that as well.
You need to understand what it is you're doing. What are the terms and conditions? What is the privacy statement? How much control do you have over your genetic material? It's your data. You should own that and you should be able to control that. And most of the companies playing at the top end of the market will make that very clear and very upfront. And if you can't find that information, that's reason to be cautious.
Well, Brad, do us a favour. For those of us who don't want to look through the fine print, word us up. What happens at your company, Ancestry.com, what happens to the data that you've collected from customers?
So you always own your data, right? You always own it. It's your DNA. And you give us permission to do certain things with it. You opt in to giving us permission to do that, matching you with other people, participating in research projects. And you can change the status of that at any time. You can get your DNA deleted, right? So you can delete your results. You can download your data and then scrub everything. And as much as I would love to give you two phrases that summarize everything, I can't do that. If you're going to participate in this process, you have an obligation to yourselves and to your siblings and your parents to understand what it is you're doing with your DNA, because it's kind of their DNA too.
And one thing that I would say as well is people should keep in mind that, you know, your question about being scrubbed forever, if you're participating in research and your DNA goes into research or it goes into a data set, Ancestry.com or the person that's holding your data can remove it from their records, but you can never get it back. Yeah. So it's always only prospective. You can't go back in time and you can't remove it from those kind of sets.
Jerome, you've been talking to families in the US, UK, here in Australia as well, about taking these online DNA tests. Why do you think people are taking these tests?
The spike in numbers in tests over the last 2 years is about marketing, bluntly. The big companies, the major companies, have been incredibly successful in selling their tests, brilliantly so, and some of the marketing has been sensational.
These companies do a great job at marketing the benefits, and if you look, it will say, you know, you might find out something about non-paternity, but obviously marketers don't want to promote that kind of thing, and people often don't go into this thinking, am I prepared to find out about things that are going to shock me? Am I ready for that? And when you go into more of the health testing, you know, are people prepared to find out about things that maybe are related to disease that maybe aren't treatable?
Do you regret taking the test?
I felt in the beginning a bit cheated because I no longer have a full sibling. I have on occasions thought, I wish I'd never done it, absolutely, because it doesn't matter who you are, it rocks your world to a certain extent.
Reg, you're 67, you're a keen family researcher. How long have you been looking at your ancestry?
About 15 years.
And then recently you took a DNA test, didn't you? What happened?
Well, I took the test because I was doing some research with two sisters, and we wanted to research our German line of the family. And when we got the test back, I didn't match any of them. So I knew that our dad wasn't dad.
How did you feel?
I just figured, well, it is what it is. I can't do anything about it. I was more interested to find out, well, who was my dad and what was going on here that this happened. And so I set about to try and find out, you know, well, who was he?
How did you go?
Well, I found him. Unfortunately, it was 2 months too late to have any contact with him because he passed away in January. But I think from the reaction of his, or my half-siblings now, as it turns out, biological, they have made it quite clear they don't want to know me and don't accept, you know, that it is what it is. I think the mother's still alive and she's quite elderly. My biological father was 93. So I think it's probably to protect her, which I can understand. So I've just, as soon as they said they wanted no contact, I was quite happy to say, well, that's not fine by me. I can't, you know, I don't want to interfere with that and create a problem.
And what about your mother? How do you feel about her now that you've discovered this?
My mum never showed a lot of affection growing up. We argued a lot and I sort of resented her for that. But I think because I've now found my biological father, I've been able to think back to what was going on in her life and it's made me think totally different about her. So it's been good that way.
Nicole, what's your relationship with Patrick like now, your dad?
This is the third time we've met face to face.
Is that right?
We do the emails and I get given advice and I go, yeah, okay. And so, yeah, it's pretty, I reckon it's probably like a teenage thing at the moment. But, yeah, we're going through that stage. Okay. So I'm hoping in the next 10 years we might hit our 20s. What do you reckon? Yes. Yeah.
How has all of this changed you?
I have three new siblings. I've met two. I've got new nieces and nephews. Patrick's now realised he's got 5 extra grandchildren and he's got 6 great-grandchildren.
13 grandchildren and 6 great-grandchildren.
And so how do you refer to Patrick now? Is he Dad or Pat?
I'm not allowed to call him Pat. But it depends. If he's cruising along quite nicely, hey, Dad, how are you going?
OK.
If he's starting to tell me I have to do things, how are you, Patrick? So, yeah.
Linda, it's been about 2 years since you discovered who your biological father is now. What's changed for you after knowing that?
Well, I've gained a lot of new family, and that's wonderful. I have found first cousins that are just wonderful, wonderful people. So that's been very positive.
So what have you done to embrace the new heritage that you've come into?
Well, I have learned that my father, my biological father, was born in New Mexico. And I had absolutely no connection to New Mexico prior to learning this. So I decided that I had to go and visit. And I took a trip. I went to the address where my father was born. And I took a little bit of the dirt from the ground. And I brought it home with me and to keep myself connected to that. To that part of me that I never knew was a part of me.
That's such a beautiful image. How about you, Rose? Has it changed the way that you view yourself?
Not yet. I'm still on a roller coaster ride. Some days I'm up, some days I'm down. I don't know how to feel yet. I don't know what my new normal is.
So, Debbie, it's been over a year that you've connected with Kim. How is all of that going, finding out who your biological father is?
I've sort of given up the search pretty much. It doesn't really worry me anymore. You know, you just have to get on with life, I feel, anyway.
Has it changed your relationships with your family?
Yeah, probably with my mother mostly. I felt in the beginning a bit cheated because I no longer have a full sibling. And that sort of did my head in a bit because I always had one up until I took the DNA test. And it puts a different perspective on everything. And you really don't know how to feel.
Kim, what's your relationship like with Debbie now?
I think it's pretty good. She is my sister. I think of her as my sister. So I think we were very lucky. I think we were lucky.
Do you regret taking the test?
I have on occasions thought I wish I'd never done it, absolutely, because it doesn't matter who you are, it rocks your world to a certain extent. No, I don't regret it. No, I don't.
What about for you, Rose? Any regrets about taking this DNA test?
Absolutely. If I had a chance to do it again, I wouldn't.
What about for you, Linda? How are you feeling about all of this in hindsight?
Well, I absolutely don't regret taking the test. I'm as difficult a journey as it was to go through. I'm really glad that I learned my personal truth.
And for you, Reg, for a time there, your world was turned upside down. Any regrets?
No, not really. No, I think it's given me a different insight into my mother, so I think it's been good in that way.
And for you, Nicole?
No. At the end of the day, I've got more in my world now than I had before, so it's pretty spectacular. He might drive me a bit balmy, but yeah, he's all right.
It was worth it.
Yeah, it was worth it.
Just Patrick, come on, stretch. How about you?
Yeah. I love it.
Just finally to our four half-siblings down the front. Any regrets from you?
For me, no. No, not at all.
And I guess the search continues in a way. For all of you, because there's possibly others out there, right?
There's six others that we know are confirmed.
Well, happy hunting. And on that note, that's all we have time for here. But let's keep talking on Twitter and Facebook.